Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Vinny Appice.
There we go. I used to do this in my basement with my mother upstairs. She had to put up with this. But I didn't have this many drums, and I don't think I played as loud back then, too. Actually, I had toms that were single head, so they weren't quite as loud as these. But I did play like this with the butt end. And, you know, it's a lot more wood on the drum when I play like this. I always said kiddingly, this is just kiddingly, girls, that they go, how come you play like this with the butt end? And I would go, because this end, this here, is for girls. Now I'm only kidding. Hang on. Yeah. I'm only kidding. It was a joke for clinics. So. But there is a big difference when you play with the butt end. You get a lot more wood on the drum, and it sounds bigger, you know, like. Now, if I turn around and play the same thing, it sounds a little different because there's less wood. You got this tip here. So it sounds like this. That's why I play with the butt end. Anyway, welcome, and thanks for joining me again. We have a lot of people online. This is cool. Somebody from Chile and somebody from somewhere else, and that's really cool. Thanks, you guys. I've been to Chile. We played with Dio in Chile. I think we played with when Bruce Dickinson left Iron Maiden, and he had his own band, and it was us. Bruce and us, and I don't know who else. I think it was Kingdom. No, it was Bonham, Jason Bonham's band when he first came out. And pretty wild. It was pretty funny down there. So, Chile, welcome, Chile. And what did we do this week? I had to go to the DMV, Department of Motor Vehicles. That was fun because I had to renew my driver's license and take a new picture. I said, why don't you, I wrote an email, why don't you use one of the pictures for my albums or for my website, you know. They won't let you do that. So I had to go drive far because the one by my house was full for a while. And that's another thing. If you're getting into business, when things like passports renewal or you got to get a passport or you got to get a driver's license to fly, don't wait till the last minute because something always comes up. Mine didn't expire till my birthday's in September. And I thought that the appointments were like the end of August into September. I don't want to get that close because something's going to come up. Hey, can you fly to New York? And then I'm in New York when the license expired and I can't drive, and that sucks. So I did it now. So it's a good idea to do that. Right. Got that out. And what else is going on? Next week's going to be a celebration for Ronnie. It's going to be his 80th birthday, July 10th. You know, may he rest in peace. We all miss him. And I must say, the music is going strong, you know. It's just all the Dio stuff and the Sabbath stuff. I was lucky enough to play on and be part of that stuff. It's amazing. So there's going to be a big shindig in L.A. on around his birthday. I got to wait for the invitation. So that's going to be fun. So it's too bad he's not here, right? You know, missing all this stuff. And Ronnie was just so wonderful. He's like a brother, an extra brother for me. I had two brothers. He was the third brother. You know, we did a lot of stuff together. And one of the things we did together was 30 years ago, a couple days ago, what was it, June 22nd, 1992, we recorded an album called Dehumanizer. And I'll tell you some facts about that. I forgot about it last week until somebody reminded me, because I'm forgetful, you know? I don't forget songs. People go, how do you remember all those songs? The songs are a little bit different, you know? And I remember I did play George Lynch a long time ago. And there were so many songs, and I had to learn them quick. I didn't know what the intros were. I just needed the riff. Then I can get the rest of the song. Sometimes if it's a new song and we haven't gone over it, I go, just play the riff. So the guitar player, play the riff. As soon as I hear the riff, okay, like three notes, that's all. And then I'm cool. But we remember, musicians remember songs. That's what we do. And these are sawtooth drums. These are the Hickory set. It's a great set. And there's a big sale going on for the next week or so. It might be a couple of weeks. If you look at the coupon that's floating around in the comments, 40% off everything on the website. So check out the link on that coupon, 40% off. So normally, I don't know what a stick costs. A pair of sticks? I don't know. Was it $200 now? Like the price of gas? But check it out. 40% off. So if you're looking for a kit, this kit rocks. This is a 6-ply Hickory drums. They come in this color, which is the dark color, and then they come in with a sugar-free blonde color, which is this. That was for you, Heidi. Blonde color here. And two beautiful finishes, and these things kick ass. They're 6-ply, all Hickory, no filler. You know, sometimes drums have filler inside, and they don't sound as good. And die-cast hoops and solid steel lugs, and you could hear how they sound here. Actually, I'm going to play you something. This is me crazy. I'm doing a bunch of work here in my studio. This is my studio recording this stuff. This is just me recording, and I put some effects on it, like verb, and I don't know what else I put on here, but I got this mic in that corner, and I call it the crank mic, and what I'll do is record the drums from that mic as well and distort it a little bit, you know, compress it, and then you mix that in with the drums. It gives you a good sound. But check this out. This is a little recording, just a 6/8 thing here. That's the end of the other song. They didn't want to leave until it ended, the band. That was Kill Devil Hill, by the way. First one was Phil Moog and me, Tracy G. And one, two. There's a lot of effect on that. I should have did one with no effect, and then that one, you know, you can go crazy with. But these drums sound great recorded. I love when the cymbals ring out. And there's a break in a song. You know, stuff like that. Zeppelin did a lot of that stuff. You hear Bonham's cymbal ringing. Very musical. You know, so check out the coupon if you need stuff, if you need equipment, and Sawtooth, they make everything, guitars, basses, and they have strings, they have cables, they have mic stands, and check it out, it's a great sale. So I'll tell you a little bit about the Humanizer. Okay, so this was the Sabbath album. I think it was the 16th album for Sabbath. And it's Tony Geezer, Ronnie, and I, right? And the first album was The Mob Rules. That was the first time I played with the band in the studio. And that kind of cemented me in the band. Like, hey, this guy's pretty good. He could fit in, you know. You got to fit in personality-wise as well in bands. You can't be, you know, yourself if you're nasty. I'm not nasty. I'm a nice guy. So it was on June 22nd in 1992. That's when the album was released. So this thing was recorded. This album was recorded at Rockfield Studios. And that's where Queen did some work as well. And it was produced by a German gentleman called Mack. And he did some work with Queen. And I think he did work with Zeppelin, too. And on this album, the drums are so cranking. And they're crisp and bitey, and it's amazing. He got such a great sound, and he always gets a great sound, but with drums screaming on this album. And what happened was when we went to mix the album, I'd been there for weeks, you know, in Wales, and I said, you know, I'm not doing anything here. Can I go home? This is nothing to do. This is before the internet. This is before late night TV and in England, the TV goes off at like 11:15, you know. There's only 3-4 stations, if you're lucky. So I went home, and then they mixed the album. Then Ronnie came home, and he came to my house and played it on a cassette. Here's the mixes. And I went, holy crap, the drums are so loud. Like, that was the intro to Computer God, and that's about how loud it was. And I went, wow, great. Actually, I said if I was there, I probably would have mentioned they may be a little bit loud. But, hey, what the heck? Usually they're too low. So that's what happened with there, and Mac just got a fantastic sound. So some facts about the album. I made a list. They're not in real order of anything sane, but there's a song on there called Master of Insanity. That was a song that Geezer's band did. He had a band at the time too, and Jim, I can't think of his last name, kind of wrote the song. He was in Geezer's band, and we played it the way we played it. And that was one of the first times I think Ronnie had sang somebody else's lyrics other than his own or Geezer's. So, you know, that was interesting. So that's a song called Master of Insanity. It was kind of a weird intro, like. Something like that. I can't. It's in an odd time, too. I should have practiced it. Sorry. And then what else? The next song I got written down is a song called After All. It's a really slow, first lyrics in the song are, what do you say to the dead? You know, it was just a really slow, heavy Sabbath song. And I kind of suggested it in the kitchen while having coffee. Like, we should do a song like Black Sabbath. And long and behold, we started messing around with it. And it's just like, that's the tempo. Really, really slow. It speeds up a little bit because back then we didn't use clicks. Nah, nobody used clicks really. So that's After All. And then the next song, a little note on, is Computer God, which I just played. And the way that we had the song and it just started, ba-da-dump, ba-da-dump. But they wanted a drum intro. So I would just sit on the drums and go, okay, roll it. That's no good. Nah, that's no good, you know. that could work. And then I finally played the one that stuck with the song, which is... And that one's cool because it kind of turns itself around. It's not all 2/4 in a snare. Right? It's not that. Good. Backwards. Backwards. See? So that one was really interesting. So we use that one. And I like to just, you know, whatever. Okay, do another one. I must have did 10 of them. And that one stuck out, like, really cool. Not too flashy, you know, just in the pocket. And, okay, next song, Time Machine. Time Machine wound up on the Wayne's World 2 movie soundtrack. And it's funny because I remember we were rehearsing the song. And first of all, the way this stuff was written, most of it, I skipped over a couple things. Cozy Powell was the drummer in the beginning. And they had a couple of songs with Cozy, but it wasn't going very well. It was going very slow and costing a lot of money. And I don't know whose fault that was, but eventually Cozy fell off a horse and broke his pelvis. And he couldn't play. So they decided to, I heard they might, Ronnie suggested Simon Wright, and Tony and Geezer wanted me. So next thing I got a call, and I flew over there, and we started working together. And we rehearsed. Ronnie and I had a house in Stafford, it's called, Shakespeare Country in Wales. And it was a big house, a couple of bedrooms, and we lived there like for 3 weeks at a time. Then we go home, then we come back, then another 3 weeks, and we'd rehearse there. Tony and Geezer could drive in. But it was really, really, really relaxed. We rehearsed in the living room. I had a set of drums, and it wasn't this set. Actually, it was Tama at the time. It was a rented kit. I had that, and then Tony played out of a little amp. It was like on a chair. And Geezer had a little bass amp, little. And Ronnie had a guitar amp that was set up on a higher chair with a mic. It looked like a beginner band. And we're in the living room, and we'd come down, you know, sometimes wearing slippers or really sweatpants. It was almost on the verge of pajamas and bring your pillow. But it was funny, and I suggested, I said, why don't we have a stage set like this, you know? It would be the living room. You know, I would be wearing slippers and all this stuff, and then maybe a robe, come out and smash this heavy music. But we didn't do that. So I ran the tape machine. We had a cassette tape machine, 4-track, and we did Time Machine, and we had the first two verses, and it was like... that tempo. And then we only had two verses. We played them at one chorus in between, and then we didn't know where to go. So Tony stopped playing, and on the tape, me, Geezer, and I, this bass one that Geezer was playing, it was cool, and I was playing, and then we stopped. Go, well, we don't know where we're going from that. So that night, I wound up listening to the tape. That's what we always did. We had dinner. And Tony Geezer went home. Ronnie and I were hanging around the house, and I listened to the tape. And went, that sounds really cool, going bass and drums with that groove, bringing it into a guitar solo. So I played it for everybody the next day, and that's what we did. And that's the guitar solo in there. It just, that was a mistake. That was not a mistake, but it wasn't planned for. It just happened. And those are the cool things when you're putting these songs together with a great band, you know. So... that's what that was. And then next song, I, that was just came out fantastic. That was Ronnie's one of Ronnie's favorite songs to play live. It was really heavy, and Tony really dug it as well. He's a vegan, so I don't know. No, I'm kidding. Sounds good. Stretch ahead. Good effect. All right. So that's I, and then Buried Alive, a song called Buried Alive, real heavy song. And check it out if you got the album on the end of the song. The song is like... Then I play it on the ends. So one, two... Hard to do with just drums alone for you to hear it, but you can hear it at the end on the vamp out. There's a couple of times I play it on the ends, which I describe as playing it backwards. You know, it's just going one, two, three, four. If you want to throw your band off, this works all the time, unless they're really good. And then what else? We had lots of Indian food. There was nothing to do there. Remember, there's no internet. There's 3-4 channels on the TV that went off early. We didn't have cable. We tried to get it. So I bought a race car set it up in the room, and I'd go up there and race these cars. Sometimes Ronnie would come up, and we'd race them. So we had TV limited and newspapers and a race car set. It was like, wow. It's like the Flintstones almost, you know. That was 1992. So the album celebrates 30 years, and I think they just remastered it as well. So check it out. It's a great album. And don't forget the coupon there for 40% off. If they sold albums, you get the album for 40% off. Okay, we have Lala in the house.
Hello.
She's practicing her drum solo like crazy. She's on the pad and everything.
Been.
Right?
Yeah. I did a little.
You did a double paradiddle. You did paradiddles, right?
Yeah.
Then you did this thing, too. You showed me that. Play that. It's the la-la bell.
I can hit the cymbal. That's it.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, you got to aim for the bell.
Okay.
See, this bell's better than this bell.
Okay.
Play Killer Phil. Yeah. So we're going to take some questions. If you haven't asked a question, you can write it on the comment section. We're going to answer a couple of questions. Then we're going to go get something to eat. Because it's so hot here, the last couple of days it's been like 110, California, kind of toward the desert, no wonder. Today's 105. What's it say on that thing? 100 and what?
I don't know. It's 100.
Cooling off down to 97.
Woo!
So we're going to go to a place that's California famous for, In-N-Out Burgers. And I know a lot of people that come into town and they're dying for an In-N-Out Burger because you can't get them in the East Coast. Because of some freshness thing they want. And you can get them here. And they're really, really good burgers and fries and stuff. So I'll burn it off. Come back on the drums. What's Beats say there? I see Beats asked the question.
What did he say? He wanted to know when there's any Last in Line shows in the Midwest.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we're going to go out with Last in Line. We're going to go out in mid to the third week in September. And then... October, there's some dates listed, I think. If not, I have to put them up there. And then they're booking November and into December as well. And, Viv's on tour with that little tour they're doing, the Motley Band and Joan Chet, you know. I don't think it, playing little places. And I think they're doing weddings now, too. Got Motley Crue, Def Leppard, and Joan Jett at the wedding.
Poison.
Oh, and Poison, yeah, that they open the wedding. That Poison plays when they open the presents. There you go. Okay, so what else we got here?
What else do we have here? Have you ever experienced stage fright or insecurity before you're playing on stage?
Have I experienced that? No, not no. Maybe the first couple of gigs. I remember the first gig was in 1970. I played. I was 13 or something, 12. And it was a church dance, and the band was on, and then we were on next, and I was like, oh, man. Heart's gone like that, and it's just really nervous. And then I got up there. I didn't look at the audience. I played like this. There's an audience out there. And then I got used to it. Now it's like, now I've been playing so long, thanks to you guys and fans around the world, that I almost know the audience. I've seen people before. So I know a lot of the people. And just like over here, I look at the people that are online with us, and we're all friends. And that's really a really cool thing. That relaxes you. But you don't want to relax too much. You want that tension, you know, the tension of, you know, sometimes I don't need, like I made a couple of mistakes in these songs. I listen to them real quick, play the sound check, and then I go, I know them, and then the part comes up and I miss it. But, hey, puts the tension in there. Okay, let's do another question.
Okay, so they were asking about the Last in Line website with the date. So it has to be updated. I don't think it's updated.
Yeah, right, yeah. So I'll have to look into that. Thank you very much. Yeah, I will look into that. Okay, what else is going on?
The Last in Line EP, what's the status on
that? Oh, man, that thing's sounding good. The video is going to come out in the next week or so, I believe, the EP. And it's got two live songs. It's got a new song. And what's the other thing that's on there? New song, two live. There's four things on there. And maybe two new songs and then two live songs. Oh, I know. There's a cover of a famous song. That's what it is. But I don't want to give it away yet. So check it out when it comes out. It sounds great. And then we're finishing up the album. Chris Collier is mixing it. He works with Korn, and he's just an amazing engineer and producer and stuff. So that stuff sounded great. It's guitars are loud. Everything's loud. It's really great. So that's not going to come out till probably next year, but the EP is due to come out very shortly. I'll as soon as we get a date or something, I'll let everybody know. Okay, what else we got here?
What else do we have?
Anybody want anything at In-N-Out?
A milkshake.
Milkshakes. Oh. I don't eat that stuff. Heidi, but sometimes Lala grabs a vanilla milkshake, and they're really good there. But, you know, your burger, I'm going to make you all hungry. Burger, cheeseburger, everything on it, fries, then you get a shake. I like chocolate.
I like vanilla.
She likes vanilla. Mm-hmm. Man, that's like, whoa. But I don't do the shake thing. No, I drink good old boring water. Water, water, water. Okay, let's take another couple of questions.
How long has it been since you played with Carmine?
Yeah, we got some dates coming up August 4th and 6th. One of them's in Buffalo, New York, and the other one's in New York City. We haven't played together in about 3 years. But nothing's changed. I still whip his ass. That's what's important. So come see us. We're going to be in Buffalo August 4th, and then we're going to be rehearsing August 3rd in Buffalo. And then the 6th is in New York City at the Cutting Room. Great, great place. Steve there, the owner, is a fantastic guy. Beautiful place, too. So come check us out. Yeah, starting to get in the swing of things. Luckily, this has kept me in shape. We'll be right back. Okay. All right. How about another question?
Do you like internal mics in your toms versus the clip-on on the rim?
That's a good question. I don't think I really had internal mics. When I last tours I did with Heaven and Hell, I had all these big, I had a million toms up in the air like this. And those were, a lot of them were internal mics. And live, the only internal mic I use now, there's a bass drum mic. It's a Shure. It's a little baby microphone. But it just cuts. It's got some bottom end and everything. Mark Weber, my drum tech and our band tech, he put it in there. It sounds great. So the clips, I'm not crazy about. Like, I was having a little buzz trouble on this tom. And I'm kind of narrowing it down to it's the clip on the drum. So I put that drum, that mic, on a stand. And it seems to help. But I heard a buzz on one of the recordings. And I went, wait a minute. So I'm not crazy about clip-on mics. You got to figure, plus I play hard. So I'm hitting this really hard. And this guy's on the rim. It's got to be vibrating, right, through the rim. So I think you get a cleaner sound if you just use mics. You know, when we go in the studio, I don't really use clip-ons, you know. So live, everybody's got clip-ons. It saves, you know, otherwise you'd be surrounded by stands, you know. It is what it is, but not crazy about them. So, how about one more question? Okay.
Are you ever going to do any drum clinics?
I would love to do drum clinics. That's not the question. The question is, the stores have to do drum clinics, or the drum companies, or the guitar companies. And, you know, I think that's kind of gone away. You don't really, years ago in the 80s, man, everybody did clinics. I used to get, you know, 10 clinics, go on tour for 2 weeks and do it. Loved it. It was great. Get to meet everybody. You play. You get to teach. And now you don't hear of clinics anymore because of the internet, and you can watch stuff on the internet. But I must say, is a big difference on watching somebody on the internet and then sitting over there where the bass drum's blowing your hair back, you know, and learning something. It's a big difference. And that's what's great about this company, ChromaCast Sawtooth. They are very proactive. It's Joe Fuco, the owner, is a drummer. And he's keeping this show on all the time. And Michael Badio, and they're very proactive in presenting things on their website, and there's always something interesting happening. We're doing something next month, too. That's going to be really cool. So a lot of companies didn't do that. They kind of didn't do anything. So maybe it'll come back a little bit. Maybe next year. Who knows? But anyway, thank you for joining me, and we're going to go to In-N-Out Burger. If you want anything, put it on the comments. We'll pick you up something.